Going to come from Ephesians chapter 5, 1 through 21. It's kind of a lengthy passage this morning, and our title today is called Different in Christ, and this is part 2. If you haven't listened to the part 1, I think it's recorded, but hasn't been posted, but we will post it. This is Different in Christ, part 2. I'll read the word. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a flagrant offering and sacrifice to God. But sexual immorality and all impurity or covetousness must not even be named among you, as it is proper among saints. Let there be no filthiness, nor foolish talk, nor crude joking, which are out of place, but instead let there be thanksgiving. For you may be sure of this, that everyone who is sexually immoral or impure, or who is covetousness, that is, an idolater, has no inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these things the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore do not become partakers with them, for at one time you were darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true, and try to discern what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them, for it is shameful even to speak of things that they do in secret. But when anything is exposed by the light, it becomes visible. For anything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, "Awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." Look carefully then how you will walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God and God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Dear God, I just pray that you may open up our ears and our hearts to receive your words, O Lord, and may they be planted inside of us so that it may be able to sprout fruit. Lord, I just pray that as we learn how to be different in Christ, I pray that your blood may cover over us, O Lord, clothing us with righteousness, O Lord, and also changing our hearts, O Lord, to be able to love you and let that love motivate us to move and change for you. Lord, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts in this room may be holy and pleasing to you. May your words be preached and may your Spirit work in our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, in my childhood, there's kind of a handful of movies that I've watched over and over and over again to the point where I not only memorized the entire storyline, but I actually memorized the entire script. You know, right before they even say something, I'm already saying it before them. And of course, if they had any songs in it, I would memorize that as well. And I wish I could say that I memorized a lot of famous literature or even Bible passages when I was younger, or I was trained in like classical reading and stuff. But to be honest, most of my childhood memories are filled with Disney movies. I mean, just watched a bunch of them. You know, I used to think that, like, these days our kids are doomed because we let them watch too much of the iPad or the iPhones, but I think it's the same back then. I had a stack of Disney movies that I watched over and over again, and we even had one of those, like, rewinding tape cassette things where, you can keep things rewinding so you can watch it again while you watch another movie, and you just keep watching movies. And I remember I used to calculate how many – my mother was a working mother, so I would calculate how long my mother would how long it would take for my mom to get home by watching how many movies. You know, I'm like, all right, I got to watch at least 2 or 3 movies, then she'll be home. And you know, that's kind of how I grew up. But as I was writing this week's sermon, a line of a movie kept repeating in my head, so I had to go back and watch the scene again. And I want to see if you guys can actually remember this. I'm going to give you a hint. It's a Disney movie. It goes like this. Remember who you are. You guys know what movie that's from? Remember who you are. Lion King. See, you guys watched it too much, too. You guys remember right away. And I don't really show movie clips that much during a worship service, but in an attempt to stir up old memories and for you guys to get to that emotional state, I did put it on the screen for you guys just to watch it. I thought this scene was just a great analogy for what we've been talking about up to this point.
That's not my father. It's just my reflection.
No. Look hard. You see, he lives in you.
Forgotten who you are, and so forgotten me. Look inside yourself, Simba. You are more than what you have become. You must take your place in the circle of life.
How can I go back? I'm not who I used to be.
Remember who you are. You are my son, and the one true king.
No, please, don't leave me. Father, don't leave me.
So let me ask you guys, did that stir up emotions from that long time ago when you were watching this and you were like, I don't know if you were like me, I don't want to sound corny, but I remember getting like the tingly nose, like, yo, he's going to go kill Scar, like, yes, and you're getting all excited about it. If you don't know the movie, this guy Simba was a son of the king and his father was murdered and his uncle took over the kingdom and everything was falling apart and he kind of grew up in paradise, forgetting all of his problems, and suddenly he's faced with reality that he needs to go back, and this is the moment, and he goes back and kicks butt with his warthog and meerkat. That's the basic storyline. But I remember, like, you know, when I was thinking about this, remember who you are, it displayed this theme of the sermon series so real. I mean, when we're talking about living different in Christ, we're not simply saying, oh, I'll do the right things in life. No, it's saying, remember who you are in God, in Christ. And history has told us that humanity doesn't really live simply for the right or wrong things in life. I mean, we don't live by mere principles, but we're motivated by what we love in our hearts, and that moves us to change. I mean, Apostle Paul begins chapter 5 with a similar reminder and says this in verse 1, "Therefore be imitators of God as beloved children." Beloved children. "And walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a flagrant offering and sacrifice to God." You know, he's saying, as beloved children, remember who you are. Remember that you are loved, and God himself, through Jesus Christ, has chosen you and has given his life for you. Therefore, mirror his character. Walk in love. Be imitators of him. Be different. Not simply because it's good to be different, but be different because you are different. You are meant to be different. You are created to be different. And that blood that runs through your body, that's the blood that comes from Christ. And it calls you. You know, as I was reading this text over and over again, it occurred to me that Paul was showing a method of different living. I mean, on the surface, it just kind of sounds like a bunch of rules, right? And I was like making a list. I was like, all right, it says don't be sexually immoral. Don't be jealous. Don't be vulgar in speech or have a potty mouth. Don't be drunk. You know, it's funny because as I was writing this list, I had the devil pop up on my shoulder saying, what a boring life. And I was like, oh, yeah, what a boring life. Don't tell me you guys didn't have the same experience. Like, oh, man. I mean, imagine like a stand-up artist that comes up and he takes all these things out. No sexually immoral jokes, no vulgar language, none of that. It's just kind of like, oh, my gosh, why is he up there? Anyways, but all jokes aside, although these are practical ways of being different in Christ and quick ways to apply them, if we closely examine the structure of Paul's content today, we can actually see that he's digging deeper into how someone can have a changed life in Christ. And I think the sermon could have actually been titled, How You Change or How People Change, which is really a bold statement, you know? It really is a bold statement. I have 3 points for us today in how we can begin to this journey and how to be different in Christ. And I'm going to label them in 3 points that go like this. Check your heart, turn on the lights, and then beware of your habits. Check your heart, turn on the lights, and beware of your habits. The first one. Check your heart. Let's read verses 3, and then I'm going to actually skip 4 and go to verse 5. It goes like this. But sexual immorality and all impurity or covetousness must not even be named among you, as is proper among the saints. For you may be sure of this, that everyone who is sexually immoral or impure, or who is covetousness, that is, an idolater, has no inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. Now, you're probably wondering, what this has to do with a checked heart? Like, what does this have to do with checking your heart? But it really has everything to do with checking your heart. Paul is basically saying, check your desires. Check your passions. Check your heart. Check what your heart is wanting. See, all throughout Scripture, sexual immorality is basically another way of saying adultery. This is having sex outside of the covenant or the promise of marriage, and it has always been used as an analogy on our relationship with God. And if we focus our shift to something else other than Him, He called us idolaters or adulterers, where we're looking at something where we shouldn't. So God's people all throughout history have been called this. See, our text is not saying that sex is a bad thing. Don't do it. Don't desire it. It's sinful. Stay away from it. I think in the past it has been wrongfully interpreted in this kind of way. And I get it. You know, I want to tell my daughter the same thing. Like, yo, stay away from it. It's bad for you. You're going to, you know, get diseases. Like, you know, which could be true in a lot of ways. But if that was what the Bible was saying, I mean, the commandment is kind of cruel, you know. But it's on the contrary. If you look throughout Scripture, the Bible, and I think all of us can maybe agree that sex is a good thing. It's a blessing. Amen? Now you guys are too holy. It's a gift of God, but only when done in the right way. I mean, Paul is definitely not saying that sex is bad, but it's horrible when it's out of its right context. And that context is wanting something that is not yours. Wanting someone else's husband or wife, or wanting a woman or a man who is not rightfully yours through marriage. It's like taking a piece of somebody without taking full responsibility. But there's a reason why sexual impurity and covetousness is mentioned together, because they work together. They're partners in crime, which because it's usually a covetous heart. If you guys don't know what covetous means, it means wanting something or having a deep desire for something, usually when it's not yours. And that type of heart usually leads to sexual immoral acts. And it was really interesting that our text calls those who are covetous, those who practice covetousness, as idolaters. He calls them idol worshipers. They want something that they shouldn't want. They place certain things at a very high level and want it so bad that they do whatever they can to get it. And these are desires that shouldn't be there, at least at that level, and therefore we call them idols. And here lies the heart of all sins. It springs. You know, a lot of times we think it's just about breaking rules. No, but the heart of sin lies at the desires of our heart. It springs from desires that are there that shouldn't be at a level that surpasses God. James 1, 14 to 15 says this, but each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire, and that desire, then desire, when it is conceived, give birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. And I think we can all agree, we know people in our lives that have idolized something at a very high level beyond God, and those things have come to destroy their life. And these are even good things in life that have destroyed it. And those idols take their time, they take their money, they steal their heart from giving it to something more important, like their families or even faithfulness to their spouses. I mean, think about it. Many have forfeited their friends for the sake of money. Many have forfeited wisdom and morals for the sake of materialistic things. People even idolize good things, right, and put them at a high level. If you idolize your children, oftentimes, you see it, you destroy your children. I mean, when Paul says, but sexual immorality and all impurity or covetousness must not be named among you as it is proper for the saints, Paul is saying, as saints, those who belong to Christ, it's not proper to have desires that are unchecked. Because that's the root of all the sins that come out. It's the root of how you live and can cause you to fall to sin, and it can cause you to do things that you might have never thought possible. See, St. Augustine, who is an early church bishop and a theologian, he recognized the human tendency that more than living for something that is logically better for you, I mean, we can know this in our heads, more than living for something that's logically better for us, we follow the passions of our heart. And quote unquote, he calls this passions love. See, for Augustine, love is not like the static thing, but it's a dynamic reality or this force. It's almost like gravity that pulls somebody from within to something else. Like it's gravity, you can't help it. It motivates you and you have a restlessness about it that you want it so bad. But according to Augustine, there's something called false love and true love. See, true love is when we love what we ought to love, and false love is something when we love something when it's not worth loving, yet we love it. And then he calls that type of love an illusion. I mean, let's place that context in the context of a husband and wife, since we've been talking about sexual immorality. Many times adultery happens because there's a longing in the heart for a person, whether to be loved or accepted, or especially for guys, we long to be respected. And along comes this young girl who thinks that we're the best person in the whole world. They laugh at her jokes and they're like, I respect you. When at that moment in time, your wife thinks you're the worst. And we grow up to think that we love her. Oh my gosh, I need her. And then the so-called love causes us adultery, causes divorce, then a broken family. And what you thought that would make you happy only works at first, only to find out later that it destroyed everything meaningful in your life. It hurt your family, your children. It killed your sense of responsibility, your integrity, and the love that you actually had for your wife up to that point. In so many other ways, you dropped it all for something so less valuable. And this young girl actually ends up leaving you for a younger guy. And Augustine calls this disordered love. He calls this disordered love, and he goes on to say, in terms of goodness and true goodness for what is proper in our lives, the love of God must be at the top of our hierarchy, because to distort that order of love is to have a false love that will not bring you true, lasting joy or satisfaction at the end. And Paul is making this analogy through a real-life example of sexual impurity and a covetous heart. And he's saying that don't have a disordered love. You have to love God first. See, at the heart of sin is this disordered form of love for things that we place above God. And that thing moves us to do things. It moves us to sin. And that shift of focus takes us away from the life that we're called to live. So how is a Christian called to be different? How are we to live differently in Christ? It's because that order of love is corrected in Christ. That order of love is changed. And God shows us what true love is and changes our heart. See, when we look at the concept of sin as simply breaking rules, then you can look at the Christian life and be like, yo, why do we even need Christ? I can live a good life. I can live a good life. I can do good things. We don't need faith. We just need like more discipline or a boot camp to change our attitude. But all throughout Scripture, the nature of what God is calling his people to do is not so much following the rules, but it's saying to have faithful love in him. And when we preach the gospel and what we call the gospel, we're not saying the gospel is not doing good things, then you are love. But the gospel is saying do good things because you are loved by God and he's changing your heart. And certainly God, as the creator of the universe, knows that love for him is the most important and the best thing for our lives, not just for this world, but even more so for even eternity. I mean, if you guys read all throughout the Old Testament, you see this theme going along. God's people are always in this battle for who they love. And it's always named as, are you going to faithfully follow God or are you going to faithfully follow other idols? And all throughout Scripture, I kid you not, just read Judges and the Kings, you're going to see a constant battle that's going on. When idolatry comes in, there comes a series of bad governments, bad kings, sexual impurity, and a society that goes down. People steal and kill, and they're moved by greed and pride, and they're weakened, and other countries come and rule them. But when they turn back to God, you see the reverse happen. The community heals. They come to repentance. Widows and orphans are cared for. There's an abundance in the land. We see wisdom and healthy kings that are humble. Because when God becomes our main love, we're moved to do what he wants us to do. We seek what's pleasing to him. And I think this is like the Simba moment, remembering the Father, looking into the water and seeing his reflection. And God, by his nature, always has the best intentions for his people. I mean, this is why I think in verses 6 through 10, it kind of says this, let no one deceive you with empty words. I think this is saying, let no one deceive you with other gods and other idols. For because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not become partakers with them. For at one time you were darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true. And try to discern what is pleasing to the Lord. Number two, turn on the lights. Let me read verses 11 and 14 to you guys. Take no part in unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to speak of things that they do in secret. But when anything is exposed by light, it becomes visible. For anything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, awake, O sleeper, and rise from the dead, and Christ will shine upon you. See, when we're talking about this momentum of how we are to change in Christ, first it begins with a heart change. But a lot of these things are an internal process where we begin to love God more, but it can't just stay as an internal process. All of you guys know that. You guys might know that you love God, but if it stays internal, what happens when isolation comes upon a person? A lot of times the worst comes out. Although we need to know that where our hearts are disordered, we can't let it stay in. It has to come out. It has to be exposed. It can't be hid under the rug, or else it will never change. You know, not too long ago, I had a friend's brother of mine call me to borrow money, and I don't know what possessed him to do it, because, you know, he knows I'm a pastor. He knows what I am. He called me a few years ago and asked me for a couple $100, and I called up his brother. I was like, yo, dude, this guy's asking me for money. What's up? And then later he's like, yo, don't give him anything, yo. He's gambling everything. He's hurting us. And I was like, all right. So I called him up, and I was a pastor then too, so I gave him words of encouragement. I was like, yo, dude, sorry. You know, you can get your head up and do all that. But not too long ago, he called me again and asked me to borrow $10,000. And I was like, oh, shoot. Like, this guy is crazy. And I almost flipped out on him. Like, I was like, yo, dude, because I knew the problems that were going on in his family, the money he squandered, the family business that was going down because of him. They wouldn't even let him work in the store because they're scared that he might take some. And after a while, I was like, yo, dude, after hearing all that, I was like, yo, dude, considering that you called me as a pastor for this, that means you have run out of options. You probably lost all your friends. Your family doesn't trust you. And you're literally killing your life. And I think up to that point, his family has just been avoiding him. I mean, I think he's a persistent liar, because he would talk about all these like business opportunities. And you can tell BS when you see it. You're just like, nah, man, you're not that wealthy. I can tell, you know, who are you lying to? But at times, I think you need to expose the truth. I mean, that doesn't mean go blast off someone, but I think you need to expose the truth to yourself. Because sometimes we lie to ourselves about certain things. We don't want to admit it. We don't want to see the consequences of where it's going. You know, I think this is why Paul is like, he's just saying, awake, O sleeper, arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. And he's talking about showing it, show light on it. You can only be redeemed of something when you constantly bring it to light. And this is not just a one-time moment of turning on the lights, but you have to constantly turn on the lights. I mean, you have to do it over and over again. I mean, in life, we always forget and we get desensitized to our own foolishness and sin. And let me show you, men in this room, let's be totally honest for a moment. Those of you guys that might have grown up in a Christian home, remember the first time when you looked lustfully at an inappropriate picture or something, and you felt guilty about it? And you're like, oh my gosh, I did something wrong. And then you remember all the sermons that your youth pastor preached or something, and you went home feeling all guilty, and then later, what happened over the years, you watched too much BET, and I don't know if you guys watch BET anymore, and MTV, and all the booties on the screen, and you watch more movies, and people do sex on TV all the time, like it's nothing. And then the computers came, and the laptops came, and by the time you're in college, you've got posters up on your wall, and you don't care anymore, and you're like, man, and everything goes crazy. You got to turn on your lights. You know, in officers training, we talked about this, how it's more recently that people are starting to face the consequences and effects of looking at those types of images on their screens and how it's affecting their families. I mean, there's so many studies that are going on that people are actually seeking therapy because they watch too much porn and it changed their mental makeup where they can't feel attracted to their spouses anymore. I mean, you got to turn on the lights. You know, I believe there's a couple of ways that we can turn on the lights in our lives. One, I'm just going to give you three quickly. One is to read God's word, because God's word reveals the sins in our lives. It turns on the light to our sin. Psalms 119:105 says this: "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." But two, I really believe that we have to verbally admit the sin and do it continually. You know, there's a reason why in every AA meeting, people are required to open up with the phrase, "My name is blank and I am an alcoholic." Because that's a moment where you flip a switch every time of the things that you're struggling with. Because at any moment, you can fool yourself into thinking that you have it under control. And that's where people fall. And you know, I actually began to make a practice of this in some areas of my life. And I remember the first time, maybe not the first time, but God reminded me or showed me like areas of pride in my life. And this happened, man, I still remember this girl that I grew up with, like in my seminary years, like she said it in such a fresh way that I got so mad, but you know, she kind of smacked me. She said, "Paul, only if you knew that if you would give up your ugly pride, you would be such a better leader." And I was like, oh. I mean, she said a lot more stuff along with that. And I remember like listening to that, and I'm like, oh, what the heck does she mean by that? And, you know, after a series of listening to different sermons and seminars about heart motives and things about idols of my heart, it opened up my eyes. And when I began to turn on those lights, I began to actually verbally admit that I struggled with pride, so much to the point where I was actually able to catch myself. You know, like when someone says something to you and they look down on you and you're like, oh, and you want to get back at them. Like, I actually caught myself like, oh, snap, your pride. And then be like, all right, Paul. Or when something happens, you're about to get jealous and you want to beat somebody for it, you're like, oh. And then I gave a compliment and said, like, you catch yourself when you admit it. And after a while, you know what actually happened? You begin to realize that humility is actually better for you than pride, because pride brings you down and humility actually brings you up. And that's a huge realization for me. But not in a fake way. Not, you know, those things are better things. But three, how we turn on the lights is we need to invite accountability. James 5:16 says this: "Therefore confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed." It's inviting different eyes onto your life. It's, you know, people are made for relationships. When we're not in relationship, it leaves our sins to go crazy. And isolation brings the worst out of us. So we have to bring it into light. I mean, I think this is why in verse 12 to 13 it says this: "For it is shameful even to speak of the things that they do in secret. But when anything is exposed by light, it becomes visible." Number three, watch your habits. Let me read to you guys verses 15 to 21. "Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand the will of the Lord, what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ." See, we see how all these things work together. As you check your heart, that enables you to turn on the lights to see where you're falling in your sin and your reality. And that helps you begin to reevaluate your lifestyle, your habits. See, when Paul uses the word walk, this word is synonymous with the word live. He says, look carefully how you live. And he says, don't be foolish, don't be unwise, don't waste your time. Now, this word time in Greek, kairos, can also be translated as opportunity, a moment in life. The fact that we have time means that God has given us an opportunity in our life. Therefore, don't waste it. See, God is taking this world to a certain direction, and our lives are small opportunity used to either meaningfully be a part of it or go the opposite way. Therefore, he says this: don't get drunk, for that is debauchery. See, debauchery in the English language means to live indulgingly to bodily pleasure. But if this word can actually be translated as an abandoned life. And I was like, also, debauchery, abandoned life. And you got to think, man, what does it mean to live in an abandoned life? It means not focused on the calling, abandoned to its purpose. It's abandoned to what is more important. See, anyone who has ever had an alcoholic in their family knows what that means, to live a life abandoned of what is more important, abandoned in the moments, losing opportunities. See, what this passage doesn't mean is we're never to drink. I mean, obviously, Scripture doesn't support that. Christ did make water into wine and you know, gave it to his disciples to remember him. But what Paul is saying is, don't be drunk. Don't let it be an escape for you to abandon your life to what you need to do. Don't let it become a lifestyle of abandonment just to get rid of your problems. Don't abandon your calling because of these habits that you take on your life. Walk. You got to watch how you walk and instead be filled with the Spirit. Being filled with the Spirit is a complete opposite. Being filled with the Spirit means that you move on board with your calling. Being filled with the Spirit is being in tune with God and means being sharp in talking about the lifestyle that God wants for you, understanding his will, as our passage says. And in turn, Paul says, worship the Lord, sing praises, have these types of habits, sing songs to God, give thanks to God, living with gratitude for his blessing and learning to submit to one another. This means serving one another. He was saying, walk in this manner, have these habits in you. You know, when I titled this point, Watch Your Habits, I say this because we might have the right heart and we might be able to turn on the lights to our sins. But even with that, I mean, we're such creatures of habit that we move along to how we have lived our lives up to this point. You know, it's funny. I know I spent a whole lot of time talking about that we make decisions based upon our passions. But on the same coin, on the other side of it, there's another reality that sometimes we don't really live out our passions, but we live out our habits. Isn't that true? A book called The Power of Habits talks a lot about this concept, saying that a lot of what we do in life, the everyday-to-day things, are 40% just habits. We do things on autopilot. For instance, you know, you wake up in the morning, you look in the mirror, you brush your teeth, you take a shower, you have some coffee, you get into your cars, and you go to work. But you do all this without thinking, and you drive all the roads without thinking about it. Like, you don't make a decision to turn, you just turn. And these also pertain to bad things in life, like eating junk food at night. You know, of course, it's horrible for our health, but we did it for so long, you know, like our kids go to sleep, we get up on our couch, we walk to the kitchen, we grab a beer, we grab a bag of chips, we sit down, you drink the beer, you have a bag of chips, you drink another beer, you get hungry, so you make more food, and then you go to sleep. And this becomes a habit without you even thinking about it. See, whenever the Bible talks about doing something always, like in our passage, it says, always give thanks. We see, and even in Hebrews 10:25, it says, don't give up the habit of getting together for worshiping God. And even to the parents, she says, train your children in God's word. Deuteronomy 6:9 says, write them on your doorposts, on your house, on your gates. Bind them on your hearts always and tie them around your neck. I think the Bible is telling us the habits that we have in life are so important, where it can either become a blessing in our life or a curse. You know, in seminary, I was super jealous of people who had developed the habit of reading. Man, those guys, like, they just read for no reason. Like, they just read all the time, and they read through all the reading lists, like, the first week it's assigned. And, you know, while I got to drink a bunch of coffee, I got to tie myself to the library and be like, Paul, you have to stay here. And I had to force myself to do it. I mean, what blessings come out of it? Now, imagine this. Imagine if we had these types of habits inside of our hearts. Not doing sexual moral acts, but being pure and focused. Not being jealous, which destroys a lot of lives, but being thankful for everything. Or maybe not being vulgar in our language, but instead singing praises to each other. Not being drunk, but be filled with the Spirit, meaning being filled with purpose and a calling in life. And this becomes so a part of our lives that we don't even think about doing it. How much would our lives be different if we no longer had to do these things as a chore and actively try, and it's done effortlessly because it's ingrained in our bodies? You know, sometimes growing up, people would look at me and be like, oh, you only go to church because you're used to doing it. You're used to doing it. You're not passionate about it. It's just a habit, as if it's a bad thing. My gosh, what a beautiful habit. You know, this habit that I have now, I thank my mother for it, for instilling it into me as a child and dragging me to church, even though I didn't want to go. But gosh, you know what that's like saying? You only eat vegetables and exercise because it's habit. Gosh, it's such a horrible thing. You're not passionate about it. Your heart's not into it. Oh my gosh, like, that's foolishness. That's the biggest blessing you can have. You know, building habits in the Lord, in Christ, is one of the biggest blessings in life. To be fed spiritually without constantly having to force yourself. I mean, you know, when we talk about quiet time and reading scripture, coming to church, coming to fellowship, these are habits that are ingrained that may not be all passionate every time we do it, but it forms inside of us an opportunity to be blessed by God, to be exposed to the Spirit. And you know, when you realize that your good habits are a blessing, usually we realize that when they disappear and they're gone. And your body deteriorates and your body gets unhealthy. It's the same in the spiritual world. How are we different in Christ? How do we change? You know, first, you got to check your hearts. Christ must be your center. He must be your main love. That relationship with him, first and foremost, that's the relationship that saves you. But two, you can't let that be inside of you, just inside of you. You have to turn on the lights. Call out your sins. See its consequences. Verbally admit them. Invite help. You can't do it on your own. Bring it to light. And three, you have to watch your habits. Let the passions of your heart in Christ move you to develop habits that glorify God and that also feed your souls. And I guarantee you'll see yourself in light of a place being different in Christ, moving to change. Let's pray. Dear God, I just want to thank you so much just for your word. I thank you for Apostle Paul, who had contemplated so hard on how to live a life different in you. Lord, I pray that first and foremost, we may never forget, oh Lord, who we are in you. Lord, as Simba's father came and said, remember who you are. Lord, I pray that that may be a voice in our heads where you constantly come and say, remember who you are. That I've died on the cross for you. That I've given my life for you. And I've given you a calling to live differently in this world. And it's a calling that is far greater than what you've been living for up to this point. And Lord, I pray that that love and our relationship with you may move us to live different lives. Dear God, there's some of us, oh Lord, that have hidden sins in our lives that we have been hiding, not talking about, putting it into our closets, not mentioning. We know that it's there, but we don't want to face it. Lord, I pray that you may help us shine light into our darkness, oh Lord, to bring them out. May you give us courage to be able to admit them so that we may be able to receive healing from you. And Lord, I pray that you may change the habits that we have, O Lord. The things that we do on a daily basis without even thinking. Dear God, I pray that our love for you may be able to form godly habits in our lives, O Lord. To read your word, to pray, to give thanks always, to sing praises to one another, to bless you, O Lord, and to worship you. I pray that those things may be ingrained inside of us, O Lord, that we may grow healthy, spiritually healthy in you. And Lord, I pray that that may enable us to live different lives in Christ. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.